Dev, Angus tells me that you're in St Kitts.
I am.
Goodness me.
Look out of the window.
Oh, my goodness me. Oh, dear. It must be such a struggle staying happy there. I don't know how you do it. Anyway, so you swapped Central London for that. I mean, I think that's a mad decision.
I know. I mean, why would you? No, it's lovely.
Welcome back to the final episode of our epic three-part series, The Health, Wealth and Happiness Conversations. Here now for your listening pleasure, happiness, now and tomorrow, which comes off the back of the launch of our pandemic Health, Wealth and Happiness report. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, then I would suggest heading back to episode one, Health. And if you want more information, head to lifesearch.com/HWH and follow us in all of your favourite social media places. But enough from me. You've already heard Tom, CEO of LifeSearch, talking to Davinia, our wealth expert, about St Kitts. Nice one, Dav. And they are joined as ever by Ali, Baz, Luke and Nina. So, here they are.
When we talk about happiness, Ali, one of the findings in the research was that 31% of people found working from home stressful.
I think the other way, obviously the flip side of that is that we can say that two-thirds of people, you know, either found no difference in their either productivity or stress levels working from home, or actually enjoyed it more. And I think what we've seen in the, certainly the way the trends have panned out, is that people, I think, have a differing reaction to the prospect of working from home, just basically based on their age and stage in life.
That's Ali Millar, author of LifeSearch's Health, Wealth and Happiness report, who heads up the creative agency Fall of Man.
And, you know, it's not a massive revelation to find out that young people who are perhaps in, you know, more cramped urban areas at the beginning of their career, they're going to crave the office, they're going to crave the workplace, because, you know, trends have moved in this direction to say that, you know, younger people actually begin to embrace and pine for the work family while they delay having, you know, their own. And the working from home dynamic really does favour parents. People have been able to claw back. I think we worked out that people have been able to claw back something like 44 minutes from the workday into the leisure day or into the downtime of the day. So I think, I mean, as ever, it's a really mixed picture the way that the stats have panned out. But I think in terms of being able to create the most advantageous environment for working from home, I know that certain organisations check in with people's mental health on a day-to-day basis. Are you having a 3 out of 5 day or a 4 out of 5 day or a 1 out of 5 day? What can we do to, you know, improve things? So I think that there are solutions waiting there for us. We obviously just haven't had the impetus, or we haven't been forced to tap into those solutions at this scale, you know, in any time in history.
That's a fascinating set of insights. At LifeSearch, we've actually had for a number of years a team that we call our Listening Ears team. And actually, there's a podcast. Can I plug another podcast on our podcast? I certainly can. The previous podcast on this channel interviewed them. And it's an amazing insight into how much good a simple structure, which doesn't provide full counselling, just provides a listening ear and guidance to people who are just having a terrible day or having a few too many bad days and who are therefore struggling. And frankly, we've all been there at some point in this cycle. That's been a fascinating way in which we've managed to help our people with their mental health. I think what that leads us on to is the question of contentment. Now, the research found that just under half of us all, 46%, are less happy now than they were at the start of the pandemic. What would be your tips for those people still badly affected in terms of their contentment? What would be your tips for achieving greater contentment?
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting one. I think happiness as a whole is going to continue to go down, because we're living in a society where everyone compares to their neighbours, compares to strangers.
That's Luke Ambler, our happiness coach and founder of Andy's Man Club.
If I look back at my granddad, my Irish granddad, he looked in paper every week till he died. So he got, weirdly, just what he used to do, and he'd go attend the funeral out of a mark of respect if he knew him. But he wouldn't have known what holiday people were going on, what shows they just bought, what they just had, what job they interviewed they had. And I think we're living in a world where what is happiness, you know? And I think it's a missold conception that everyone can be happy. Happiness comes and goes. Tips for contentment. I don't think there is tips. I don't think there's activities for contentment. I think there's one mindset shift. And it's what an 11-year-old girl told me in Burnley when she told me her favourite quote, which was, when you appreciate everything that you have everything that you need. And I think too much now, everyone's looking extrinsically rather than inside. You know, it's an internal job, is contentment. It's like, what do you have in your life? Who do you have? It's quite easy to look at everything you don't have. It's easy to look at everything that you can't have right now. And that's been the biggest thing of the pandemic. We've been told everything that we can't have, but the ones who've succeeded in this pandemic mentally, the ones who've gone, okay, I can't go to gym, but I'll do an home workout. Okay, I can't do this, so I'll do that. There's a lot of activities that we are able to do, but it's easy to get bogged down with the things that we can't do in it. So for me, contentment, it comes out of appreciation, it comes out of gratitude. And I see these type of words getting thrown around everywhere nowadays, which sounds amazing. But I'm talking about like real gratitude, like genuinely, like feeling what you're saying and like feeling on a daily basis and building on that. It's easy to get bogged down in it with everything that we can't have. So that'll be mine. I think happiness is going to continue to dwindle unless we do get a grip of that thing between his ears and start to look at the things that we do have.
I completely agree with what you're saying. And actually, that 11-year-old that you spoke to is wise beyond her years and already sounds like she's got an amazing foundation for her entire life. But I think I actually would challenge or counter the point that there isn't a formula for achieving contentment, because maybe there isn't a formula per se, but I definitely think that it's not, and this is kind of tough love, Dav speaking, I don't think it's okay for us as adults to say, you know, we have no control over our contentment. So your point about gratitude, I think, is spot on. But I think that there are practical things that we can do to help us to recognise that. And it might be spending 5 minutes a day gratitude journaling, which may sound like a woo-woo thing to do. But when you start to write things down and you see those things compound over days and weeks and months and then you read them back, it's that can have the feeling, the overall sense of well-being that you get from, you know, reflecting on the fact that things may not necessarily be as bad as how you've catastrophized them in your mind. That's powerful. I think there's also some discipline that we need to exercise over what we allow ourselves to consume, because nobody's forcing social media down our throats. We can delete the apps. We can control how much time we spend on various apps. And so I think sometimes it's easy for us to step into the realms of, oh, you know, I went on social media and I saw my friend doing this or that. And I think we have to take some responsibility for the extent to which we allow that to pollute our minds and assault our senses. We have to take a step back and say, I'm not going on there because I feel much better when I reflect on what's happening within my life and reflect on the things that I'm able to control and, you know, see the joy in that.
I completely agree about journaling. I brought out a journal called BU Journal. I'm not plugging it. I completely encourage people to do that exact same thing in the morning. But where like you're talking about tough love, wouldn't it be great to get to a point where you can go on social media and it not affect you? That's what I'm saying. So like rather than try to put stuff off, so like, no, okay, I'm not. For example, if you're on a diet, like if you restrict yourself completely where you never eat bad food at all, like I don't think that's quite good for you, is it? Where you've got to be completely everything controlled. What I'm saying is be able to go on social media, and if your mindset says, I see that my friend is on holiday and he's having an amazing time and looks like he's got a perfect girlfriend, perfect life, by accepting that I've also been on holiday, took a picture of my girlfriend and had an argument straight after, and I want, okay, accepting that. So that's what I'm saying. So it's like a level up. So you're saying, okay, like if at first you maybe have to control what you're seeing on social media, but when you can get to the point where you know that behind every picture is just a life just like yours, that's when I think that you become content. That's why I'm saying look inside first, and anything external doesn't affect what's going on inside, because you don't allow it to, because you understand it, you accept it, you're self-aware enough to go, shit, like I know that whatever they've bought or whatever the thing isn't going to make them happy. Like, and I don't need to try chase that to make me happy, because contentment's an inside job. So I completely agree. But I think, yeah, you got to get to a point where you've got that control, but in a sense that you don't have to completely limit yourself to everything. So yeah, I agree.
I know you can actually attribute, a psychometric scoring to the value of writing a gratitude list. It's proven to, you know, a kind of score degree that helps one's mental well-being for the day or for the week. I think there's an interesting stat that came out in the consumer research that we did to underpin the report, which kind of sits somewhere in the middle of what you're both saying, and it's that trust in social media influencers has actually taken a real nosedive during the pandemic. And social media influencers, I mean, they're a whole brand architecture relies on public trust, especially the heaviest social media users are younger people and women. And they've lost the most ground in those two groups. So it could be the pandemic effect. It might right itself in, you know, a few weeks or months' time. Perhaps they've been caught up in the, you know, the tailwinds of the fake news and of the, you know, the antivirus, pro-virus, anti-vaccine, pro-vaccine kind of rhetoric that we've all been bombarded with. But there's something quite interesting happening, I think, on social media, where the trust levers are kind of moving in directions that they haven't necessarily been seen for the last 10 years in the social media era. And I think it'll be quite interesting to see how that kind of bears out.
I was just going to say that kind of, I think in the world of fitness, where I come from, it's, you know, pre-pandemic, it was like, it was super motivational and it was super like high energy and it was super in your face. And it's like, if you set yourself a goal and you can lose this or you can do this. And that's not what people want right now.
The voice you're hearing right now is Baz Moffatt, LifeSearch's health coach, women's health expert and former Olympic rower.
They're like, oh my God. Like, so that was how, you think back to that first announcement of Boris Johnson when he said, like, we're going into lockdown, like all the fitness people got on and there was like, you know, there was Joe Wicks bouncing around and everyone was like, all these celebrities were getting on the bandwagon. But then over time, people don't want that. And they were using exercise for different reasons. They didn't want to be beasted by a session. And I think that, and they stopped enjoying what the influence, the fitness influencers anyway, were saying. And I think it was those that were authentic, genuinely authentic, and said, God, you know what? Like, I'm really struggling. I really don't like this. They're the people that got cut through, not the people that just pretended that they were all great and they presented in full makeup and like full, you know, fake tans and bouncing around. It was just like, oh, come on, you need to connect with what real people are experiencing here.
You know, you've said the one word that has been going round my head throughout the pandemic, which is authentic. I do think we've automatically all become much more ourselves. Dav, you talked about the mum you and the work you, and the fact that you can now blend the two quite happily. And at LifeSearch, one of the best things I ever said was in the first weeks, I said, LifeSearch does not mind if our customers hear your children screaming. It's okay. Put them on your knee and I bet you the customer will empathize with you because they've probably got kids too. So don't worry about it. So authenticity and being real, I think, has been greatly encouraged. What really worries me, and Nina, I don't know from your perspective, you're a crystal ball gazer of the highest order. How can authenticity survive the reintroduction of the real world? How can we keep the interesting bits of good that have come into our psyches through the suffering of the pandemic, as opposed to just go back to the way we were before? Because I don't think anyone really wants to, in a helter-skelter, flat out all the time. But how can we avoid that happening to us?
There's various, I guess, ways to approach that question, I guess, from the sort of, you know, crystal ball gazing economics aspect. You know, we have been trying to answer questions like, you know, most people that have been working from home want to keep working from home at least part of the time. Even if, you know, doing so entirely, they've found it stressful and unpleasant. They still, I think still, there's quite a large number of people that want to keep some of the features that have arisen.
And just in case you were wondering, that's Cebr CEO, economist Nina Skero talking.
So I think sort of in the next period, and, you know, we mentioned earlier, a lot of us are hopeful that this is kind of the last phase of the pandemic, whether that's going to end up being true or not. It's hard to say. But if we assume for a second that it is, the next big question is how much of our new way of life is here to stay and how much of it is going to fall by the wayside. And, you know, how do we consciously make sure that the parts of our, you know, the new habits that we're going to end up keeping are the ones that we're going to want to keep. And it's also not very clear cut to say, well, which are the habits that we want to keep? You know, if you are someone that has absolutely loved working from home, if you're someone that has really enjoyed that, then for you, that's something you're going to want to try to keep. If you're somebody who is, I don't know, a dry cleaner or a local lunch shop that's located in the middle of a bunch of tall business buildings, then you're going to hope that that's something that's going to turn out to be a really, you know, short-term impact of the pandemic. So it's very hard to say what we want to keep, what we want to go back to the old ways.
Well, I wonder if that doesn't start to draw us to a conclusion if I ask the others then. So what should we keep to improve the sum of human happiness? And Ali, I wonder, does the research throw up any particular aspects of life that have increased happiness?
As always in these situations, you do get something of a tale of, you get a fat middle and you get two extremes. And the fat middle was that for a lot of people, life didn't change all that much. And then at one extreme, which I'll go into, you had things that got notably worse. And for another extreme, you get things that got considerably better. The better you got depended on your starting point, and the starting point on various socioeconomic variables or measures. If you had savings in the bank, if you had a decent job, if you had, you know, some degree of security, be it in your house or whatever. And the more people you had around as well was another variable. The more people you had around, that you know, the more likely you were to have sort of almost enjoyed the lockdown experience. There was an episode of Newsnight that I vividly remember at the very beginning of the pandemic where Emily Maitlis went into something of a filibuster. And she talked about how the rhetoric at the time was that rich and poor, the pandemic was affecting everyone equally. And she went off on a tangent and said that's absolutely not the case. The BBC came in for a whole lot of criticism on the grounds that it breached its impartiality, or it got a little bit political. And in a sense, it did. But there was nothing wrong in what she was saying. So there is a material link between what people experienced in the pandemic and their starting point. And I think it's one of these things that possibly needs to, you know, be addressed in the recovery, whatever shape and form that takes, is that the, you know, we know the socioeconomic groups that were hardest affected by the measures taken in COVID's name, and gig economy workers, let's say, people who live in busy households, urban areas, who are reliant on public transport, key workers, health workers, they were more exposed to not only the pandemic or the virus itself, but the measures taken in its name, and most likely to be adversely affected, you know, in the wake. And these are things that, these are kind of smaller groups, smaller subsets of subsets, but the extreme experiences, the extreme pandemic experiences, which aren't necessarily going to reflect in the national averages and the indices, are the ones where people really need to put the magnifying glass and focus resource, because that's where the real hurt is going to be felt, I think, in 6 months, 12 months, 18 months' time.
It's interesting that we saw, according to the global stats, that the UK's sort of happiness plummeted further than other countries and is now bouncing back faster than other countries. It seems we're a bit of a yo-yo. Any ideas on what society, you can pin it all on the government if you like, but any ideas what society and what individuals and what communities and government, what is the catchphrase? Build back better? That, you know, that sounds all right to me as a concept. What on earth does it mean? What should we all be doing to build back better, not just ourselves, but those around us and those we know who've been hardest hit?
I think it's about looking at lessons that we've learned. Yes, I think some of your best lessons in life come from your hardest times, don't they? I know in my life it has. Anyway, like any shit I've been through, that's when I've learned the biggest lessons. I know for me, I can only speak personally, I know that I'll be spending a lot more time, quality time with my kids. I'll be a lot more present than I have been. You know, we're very guilty in past that I've not. So, but what we can all do ourselves is take stock. Take stock of what you've done. I know a lot of people where I'm from, we've loved getting outdoors. We are very lucky where I live in Yorkshire that, you know, we're in God's own country, aren't we? And we can literally get out into moors at any point. I've seen families out walking and doing stuff that they wouldn't normally do. You know, where kids used to have iPads stuffed in the face and adults be on phones. Yeah, it's still there. But I think people are more aware of the benefits of getting outdoors, enjoying nature. So when you're bouncing back, I said 2 weeks ago, just before the world opened up, it's going to open up and it's going to open up real quick, and it's going to get quite overwhelming. I know personally, my missus has gone, she's got her own business, she's gone back to work. I've got kids club every single night. Diary's gone from being pretty flexible to pretty much down at a minute. And that creates its own pressures and stresses. So it's like just taking stock, taking a minute just to realise, like, what were good. Don't lose sight of them Saturday, Sundays with your family. If you've got family, if you aren't, connecting with friends, you're allowed to go back outdoors now. And just looking at what's important in your life getting back to those roots. It'd be quite easy quickly to get back into that material game, to chasing stuff, to being out there all the time before you know it. And suddenly those lessons, it'll be 5 years ago, you'll be talking about this thing called a pandemic that happened, and I was all back to normal. And my question is what do you want your normal to be?
I'm just going to echo really what Luke said. Like a year ago, we had to self-isolate for 2 weeks and I had a 4- and a 5-year-old and we live in a flat in London. And I was like, holy shit, how on earth are we going to manage that? And it was amazing. They absolutely thrived throughout the whole of this lockdown. And it wasn't because they were sat on iPads or phones all day at all. They just played and played and played. And they slept together in their bed. They bonded as brothers and it has just been so good for them. And it just, even when we came out of that 2 weeks of lockdown, I was like, all right, we're going out now. They're like, nah. I'm like, are you kidding? That we've been stuck in this flat. And it just, and since then, it's like, we just have days when we stay in our pajamas all day and we have amazing days. And it's taken away the pressure of me of like what I need to do to be a good parent. It's like, you know what? Like the kids just want you. They just want you to be with them. So I'm, you know, competitive being an ex-athlete. And I get pulled into this like, oh, all these other kids are doing all these clubs and all these other parents are doing this. And I'm like, you know what? I actually know what our family needs now. And I think without this lockdown, I would never have trusted how little we need to do. And now I really do.
I've got a wee boy who went from 4 to 5. In fact, just as the first lockdown hit, he went from 3 to 4 and then recently went from 4 to 5. And another one instantly on the way. My wife is 9 months pregnant right now. And as a side note, I kind of thought that there would be more of a spike in a birth rate during COVID than we actually saw. In fact, the opposite happened. The UK's, well, certainly the UK's birth rate went south, whereas I think a lot of people possibly expected that for obvious reasons it might do the opposite. But I think what I found quite interesting was my little boy, who 25% of his life now has been during COVID times. That side troubles me slightly into how that will pan out. You've got a whole generation of kids who have delayed exams, deferred exams. Remember the fiasco from, you know, 12 months ago or slightly less. So that side of things, you know, possibly the repercussions of that could still be in store, and it's worth sort of, you know, bearing that in mind, that a whole generation of students have had their education absolutely upset. My little boy is at the kind of nursery stage, so his developmental stages, luckily for us, I mean, he's been going through all that in-house, so we've been able to spend just that bit more time without, as people have said, without the pressures of feeling that we need to send him to every after-school club under the sun because the Joneses are doing that. I do know that, you know, there is a generation of students who are possibly going to find themselves on the back foot in days to come as a result of the pandemic experience. And, you know, that's a potential hurdle that's going to have to be addressed.
I don't argue with you at all in anything you've said, but I do think that the protecting the space, the time at home, the bonding you will have done with your wee boy is in an entirely different level to the bonding I did with Angus when he was that age, because I was running around like a mad dog, running a business, having meetings 24/7, and making sure I did whatever fatherly duties I was ordered to do. Whereas a year where your children have been in your presence and you in theirs for a whole year, that's, wow, when last did that happen to mankind? Mm. Both parents. I mean, that's a thing. And I would say for all the academic struggles that you know what? Academics, it's a race. You just run it as best you can. You come out the other end as educated as you are and you make of it what you will.
100%.
And if you have to spend another year getting your doctorate, well then, geez, good luck to you. Or even getting an O-level. But for me, the sheer quality that you've had injected into your life as a young person by your parents for this year. I mean, there are 1,000 different experiences and I'm painting a very rosy one. Indeed, we've all painted pretty rosy ones, and I realise that is not true of a chunk of society and any number of individuals. But for those who have had a conventional family time through this, I think there's just way more they're going to get out of being with their parents all this time than they would have got out of a year in school, even if their education did slow down a bit. But hey, maybe that's a natural optimism.
I think the thing for me is that we shouldn't feel under pressure to immediately ricochet back into our old lives. I think, you know, we've got a really good opportunity now to pause and reflect on the things we want to keep and the things we want to get rid of. And so we just have to be quite ruthless in terms of saying these are the things that were really good about the pandemic. Not everything has been terrible. You know, we've got to reflect on the things that we really want to keep and, you know, protect that, just guard it furiously so that we don't feel compelled and that we don't just drift and then years later go, how did I find myself here in this job, in this area of the world that I don't necessarily want to live in this relationship that has been dead for 20 years, like whatever the situation might be, you know, really just being mindful about all aspects of our lives now and not just allowing life to happen to us, I think is really important.
I think what you've just said there is it's about it. I think it's going to be harder to protect the space and do less than it is to do more. Like, it's easy to fill everything up, isn't it? Like, to put more and more and more in. And actually, I've now realised how much effort you have to put in to doing nothing.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's so important, so important.
And there you are. That's your lot, folks. A massive thank you to Ali Millar, Baz Moffatt, Davinia Tomlinson, Luke Ambler, Nina Skero, and Tom Baigrie for giving us such an interesting conversation. And a final reminder that if you want to learn more about LifeSearch's Health, Wealth and Happiness Pandemic Report, then head to lifesearch.com/HWH or follow us in all the usual social places. This has been Searching for Elephants, and if you want to hear more of the conversations we're having inside and outside LifeSearch, then you know what to do. Like, subscribe, and give us that beautiful 5-star review.
So thank you all very, very much indeed from me and LifeSearch, and lots of love.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Bye.
Thank you.
Cheers, all. Thanks so much.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
You too. Bye. See you.
Bye. Searching for Elephants is mixed and composed by Patrick Baigrie, and the show was created and edited by me, Angus Baigrie.